This podcast is brought to you by Most Valuable Podcasts, leading the league in podcasting entertainment.
What's up, what's up? Real MVPs, Ricky Widmer here, along with the one, the only, Brandon Swanee Swanson.
Hey, hey, hey.
And we are back for another edition of the Primetime Podcast right here on Most Valuable Podcast, your one-stop shop for everything college football and college basketball. Maybe one of these days, like, we'll venture into college lacrosse or college baseball, but for right now, it's the main two. It's college football, college basketball. We are continuing our football previews, getting ready. We are now, Brandon, 3 weeks away from the beginning of football season for the Primetime Podcast. August 27th is not only our first picks podcast, it is also where we're going to make our predictions for the season. I can't wait.
I'm pretty excited. I mean, it's been a long time, and I know that people will say, well, you know, that's the end of summer. You know, they're like, I want college football and I want NFL, but I don't want summer to end. Well, you can't have both. So you just kind of have to wave bye to summer and say hello to fall and embrace it. And it should be a lot of fun. Every single season is always a good time.
I mean, technically we have games the week before on the 25th. People are going to say, but guys, we've got games on the 25th, but they're games that involve like UMass and Rice and Hawaii and Colorado State and New Mexico State and a Josh Allen-less Wyoming Cowboys. So they're games that I really don't care about. I'm sorry. But so August 30th are the true start for me for the college football season. But in today's podcast, we are continuing our previews. Like I said, we're taking a look, continuing in the Big Ten Conference, and we're going to look at the Big Ten Beast. East, but I like to call it the Beast. Before we get into everything, a little bit of housekeeping for you guys. First off, make sure to check off patreon.com/MostValuablePodcast. Last week, we had Matt on to talk about his Purdue Boilermakers. If you want to be like Matt, make sure to check out the $10 tier on Patreon so you can help support the channel and be on a podcast of your choosing. Also, make sure to check out that store link either in the description or at MostValuablePodcast.com. You can get yourself an MVP t-shirt too. Mark put it the best way. Maybe it's laundry day and you don't want to do laundry. That's okay. Just buy an MVP t-shirt. Then you don't have to do laundry and you get an MVP t-shirt. It's a win-win either way. You can also go to mostvalpodcast.com to catch MVP each and every day. And if you have Apple Podcasts, you're on Apple Podcasts, you have iTunes, make sure to give the Primetime Podcast a 5-star rating and let people know why you like listening to the podcast. Because apparently right now that one rating is still there. We're just a couple of good old boys that talk about the SEC. Although today we are not talking the SEC.
We haven't actually talked the SEC in weeks.
I think it's been months that we haven't talked because they were the first previews that we did. And I think half of those previews, it was Sean and I and not you and I. So, I mean, it's an interesting little comment. Make sure to go change that and write on our iTunes page why you like listening to the Primetime Podcast each and every week. But let's get into it, Brandon, talking about the conference that I like to call the Big Ten Beast. And I love to talk this conference because it's got three or four of the best teams in the Big Ten all in this side of the conference. How we do things is we start from the rankings last year, the standings last year. We start from the bottom. We go all the way to the top, looking at each team in the division. Let's start off with the bottom feeder. I'm going to say the bottom feeders from last year only because they were one of the 2-7 teams last year. We're going to look at the Indiana Hoosiers to start the podcast. And here's the first question I want to ask you. Usually a Ricky Widmer question is, so what about this quarterback decision that they have to make? Because the Hoosiers do have a quarterback decision that they have to make. But I want to start this podcast off with the defense. This was a defense last year that Tom Allen, in his first year as head coach of the Hoosiers, he made them a respectable defense last year. They were one that limited opponents to just over 25 or around 25 points per game. They were the sixth best defense in the Big Ten all of last season. That is all 14 teams. They were the sixth best defense. However, this is a team that is going to lose two of their top linebackers in Scales and Covington, and they are going to have guys coming back off of injury. The first question I want to ask you about this team is, can this defense produce at the same level that they did last year to be the sixth best, if not better, this year in 2018?
I think that this defense could probably do that. You know, you look at what they were able to do last season, and they held opponents to 25 points per game, right around there. And then you even look at some of the games that they played last year. You know, it was a really close game against Michigan, 27-20 in overtime, 17-9 on the road at Michigan State. You're close against Maryland. You're close against Purdue on the road. Mm-hmm. There were a lot of good things there. And that defense was a really big part of the reason why it was so positive. And you mentioned you lose a couple of guys, but this team and Tom Allen as their head coach is a guy where a lot of people are going to say, as they have been saying, you know, look at what he's done defensively. The biggest issue is probably going to be making sure that they still have things or will have things set on the offensive side, because defense is more of his stronger suit. It's more of the stronger point with Allen as the head coach. So, yes, you do have to replace a couple of these really important studs that you have from last season, but you're not replacing every single guy on the defense. And because you're not doing that, you're still going to have a number of areas and a number of players who are going to be stepping into a role or just taking on a bigger role. Mm-hmm. The question's going to be, are they ready for it and can they shoulder the load?
Yeah, I mean, really the big question when it comes to defense, like for the entire team, the biggest question is for defense, can they get over the one? Number one thing is, can they get over the loss of, most importantly, Scales and Covington? But for both offense and defense, the main question is, can the players, because they had a lot of injuries last year, can the players who were injured last year come back and produce it the way they need to produce? Like one player on the defensive side, Niall Skiles, he's got a return from injury. Is he going to be able to produce on the edge like this team needs? Also defensively, the question that I have is the switch in teams that they will play in the Big Ten. They're going to play all the Big Ten East teams. Like, there's no problem there. But last year, you look at the schedule, you get an Illinois team that 14 points. That's not too bad for defenses. But that Illinois team last year was very inexperienced and was a shell of itself and couldn't do anything. Whereas this year, instead of Illinois and I'm trying to look like a Wisconsin who blew them out 45-17. You get teams more, I'm going to say one that's in the middle, Iowa. What are we going to see from them? And then Minnesota. Is that going to be, I'll ask you this, on the terms of the defense, do you see this as more of a, wow, this is favorable because Iowa compared to Wisconsin is a step down from Wisconsin, and Minnesota, Illinois could be right around the same? Or will this be a, you know what, Iowa might be a step down from Wisconsin, but Minnesota's a little bit of a step up from Illinois? Which side, which kind of perspective do you take with those two? Because I may be leaning towards the second one, depending on what we see from Minnesota this year.
You're talking about the schedule as a whole. Are you talking about looking at these teams on the schedule?
I'm looking at a microcosm of just those two games, because those are the two in conference that switched from last year. Last year it was Wisconsin-Illinois. This year it's Iowa-Minnesota. Is that going to be better for this defense to go up against those two compared to Wisconsin-Illinois, or is it going to be worse?
Well, it's going to be better because you're not getting Wisconsin.
Mm-hmm.
Wisconsin's the best team on the other side, okay, and possibly the best team in the Big Ten when it's all said and done. Minnesota is a team, and we've talked about them, that they've got some things that they still need to work out, and they've got some things that they need to work out on both sides of the ball as well. And then Iowa's still going to be a good team. They've lost some really big playmakers defensively as well, but they'll still be a good team. I like this better than what they saw last year, because you put Illinois in there, and Illinois has been really down for a number of years, and especially here under Lovie Smith. But Wisconsin was in there. It does not matter who else you put in. Wisconsin was in there, and that's a game that already you would look at and say, you know, there's probably a pretty good chance that we lose that game if we're Indiana.
Mm-hmm.
But you have a chance. And in talking about this defense, what Tom Allen did this season is he had a really good recruiting class, and he had a really good recruiting class in terms of how athletic they are and what they bring to the table in terms of their athleticism, their intangibles, and all those types of things. And you look at the defense, and I think that would be just the same. While you are losing some players, you have guys, and especially in, I think, the secondary that will step in and be some athletic players. So it will be, again, something where you're always going to hurt when you lose really, really, really crucial guys to your program and to what you're doing on the field and what you're doing in the locker room and off the field. But you have to believe that you're going to get guys in there, new guys who are going to have the same impact, if not somewhat hopefully better, and, you know, be better than, you know, every other person that comes in there. Because if you do that, you're going to, you know, lead to that culture of excellence and then hopefully winning. I don't worry too much about that. Like I said, it's more for me where you look to the offensive side and say, we've got to do better than 23 points a game. If our defense maybe gives up, let's say, one more point per game, and you're giving up 26 points per game, okay, you went up a point. But if you're, you know, around there, anywhere between 25 to 26 still, I think that you can call that a win.
Well, let's move over defense to offense. And we talked about the defensive totals, like I said, around 25 points per game is what they were giving up. The offense wasn't scoring a lot. They were scoring about 23 points per game, which, if you look at the averages and just do it mathematically, you're still getting outscored. Bingo. That's why you're 2-7 if we're going basis. But there were a lot of games that were definitely blowouts, especially late in the year. There's a quarterback decision that the Hoosiers have to make. And to me, there are really two, three options, I'm going to say. The first option is, do you go with the guy who last year is a part-time starter, didn't do bad, Peyton Ramsey, however, he's coming off of a knee injury. That's option one. Option two is you go with a guy who is transferring. He's a starter that is transferring from the Arizona Wildcats. He came in 4 days before your spring game. Do you go with him? Or the third option, this is the last option I don't think will happen, but I'm putting it on the table anyways, is do you say, you know what, screw those other two. We are going to go with a guy in Michael Penix, who basically is coming in fresh. He's a freshman, but he threw 61 touchdowns in high school last year. For me, I think that if it was me, I'm going with a guy that is, I'm going with either Ramsey or Dawkins. I'd probably side with Ramsey, depending on A, where the knee injury is for Peyton Ramsey, and two, depending on how they look. But right now I feel like Brandon Dawkins might be the one that gives you a better chance to win, because he's the healthier quarterback and he might be a little bit better of a starter coming from Arizona than Peyton Ramsey. However, Ramsey knows the system in Indiana a little bit better than Dawkins. What would you do? Dawkins, one of the freshmen, or stay with Ramsey?
Well, first of all, I don't think they are going to be going with one of the freshmen, because it was 4 days before spring camp and they brought in
a transfer,
Brandon Dawkins. So they clearly didn't believe that they had what they needed in terms of competition with the freshmen in-house for sure with that. But they also didn't know if Ramsey was going to be 100% healthy when the start of the season came, because they needed to have somebody else. And it makes sense, certainly, to have somebody else there too, even if you believe he could be and would be. So the thing with Ramsey is that he doesn't have the best arm. He lacks considerable arm strength. that you would want to see in a really good, reliable quarterback.
Mm-hmm.
But Dawkins on the other side, in 3 years over at Arizona, he doesn't have standout numbers. And now you need to have standout numbers to come over and be a starting quarterback? No, you do not. But if you want to be a quarterback on a team that's going to be getting better and that you want to see get better, and you're going to be kind of handed the keys to the kingdom and be the guy who helps it to get there, you want to be doing that with a guy who you think is going to be very capable to do that. If you mm-hmm. want someone who's just capable, I think that you could probably go with Ramsey. But if you want someone who's, you know, going to get you to the next level, I still don't know if that's going to be Dawkins. They may have to wait a year and give it over to Penix.
True. And I mean, for me, that's the big thing, that the only reason why I mention Penix, and the thing that I'm looking at here at an article on the Charlotte Observer, they have an article about the Indiana quarterback battle. Really, the two that they mention, like they mention graduate transfer Brandon Dawkins, because he's got more college experience. Ramsey's the guy who obviously has experience starting for the Hoosiers. But then Michael Penix, they put here, and true freshman Michael Penix Jr., who enrolled in January, so he could get a jump into the competition. And for me, the only reason why I put Penix into this discussion is the fact that you see a number like 61 touchdowns in high school. And for me, if I am a team that only scored 23 points per game last year and needs more scoring, I know he's the most inexperienced of the bunch. But you see that type of touchdown number, and the first thing I think of is, can he get us in the end zone? Because in the end, that might be the main decider of the Hoosiers, is which one of these quarterbacks, I know it sounds very simple and very like, hey, thanks, John Madden, boom, but who's going to get us into the end zone the most, and who's going to get us into the end zone the often? The most often. The other thing that you have to mention with the offense is, how is Nick Westbrook going to come back to this team? He's a guy who injured himself on the opening kickoff last year against Ohio State, and he's a guy who had almost 1,000 receiving yards the year before, had 6 touchdowns the year before. And the other two questions that I have is, first off, Nick Westbrook, how is he going to come back from injury? But then this running back core too, because the stat that kind of jumped out at me from last year is Indiana failed to produce an 1,000-yard running back for the first time in 4 seasons last year. That to me is a problem. You got to have a more consistent run game, and you need Westbrook to come back and be the main target for whatever quarterback you choose to put behind center.
Well, Morgan Ellison, though, at running back, he had a number of 100-yard games. Mm-hmm. He averaged 5 yards per carry on the season. You just need to see that more consistently.
Yep.
And that's what that needs to do. If he can do that, what you're saying, your mm-hmm. thought to the Indiana running game, that should be cleared up pretty quickly. But that also comes with consistency, and it comes with consistency at quarterback, and that's going to be one of the number one things. And everyone has to remember, too, and as do we, that Ramsey was last year just a freshman. He's just a freshman last season, so he has time to grow. He has time to get better, and then it was cut short due to a knee injury.
Mm-hmm.
So there's a couple of things that were working against him there, but I would start with him. He's got weapons. There are going to be guys there. Like you said, there's guys returning from injury. There's guys who are licking their chops to get better in year number 2, year number 3, whatever it may be for them. They've got an offensive line that looks to be more improved. They get a transfer over from Miami to be their center. There are things going well here for Indiana.
Mm-hmm.
And Indiana, as I've talked about before, I can't remember if it was on the other Big Ten a preview or if it was just another team and I brought up Indiana about something, but they're one of those sneaky teams a lot of the time. And I'm not saying that, well, Brandon, what do you mean they're sneaky teams? They've been kind of, you know, wavering at 5 wins, 6 wins for a while. But that's the thing, is that they're this close to being like an 8-win team. If you look at, and I'm not saying in terms of necessarily all the talent they have compared to a team like an Iowa may have or somebody else in the Big Ten, but if you look at some of the games that I talked about earlier, that I brought up earlier, the Michigan State game, what was another one of the games that the Maryland game.
Mm-hmm.
If you have a ball bounce or something goes differently, you may have won that game. You may have won that game. And that to me, or the Michigan game where you go to overtime and it's 27-20. I know Michigan was in a down year last year, but still at the same time, Indiana is sticking in these games, and they were sticking in those games.
Mm-hmm.
And that speaks, again, to their defense. But it speaks to, are they that far off? Are they that far off from being a team that could jump into the middle of the pack?
And that's the thing to kind of cut you off is ever since 2014, Indiana, for me, has always been that team. Like, are they a good team? I would say no. Like, you look at their record, like, in 2014, they had 4 wins at the end of the year, 1 Big Ten win. However, they were always that team that if you were like an Ohio State, a Penn State, you were coming in, don't sleep on them. Like,
absolutely.
They lost 13-7 against Penn State in 2014. 2015, that was the game they played number 1 Ohio State at home, almost beat them, I believe, but lost 34-27. That was also the year that I think they had a big upset. No, it was the number 9 Iowa they almost beat. They lost 35-27. And it was the double overtime game against a ranked Michigan team that had to go to double overtime in order for Michigan to get a 7-point win, 48-41. Then you jump ahead, 2016, overtime win against a ranked top 20 Michigan State team. And they lose 27-22 against a top 10 Cornhusker team that year. Penn State, 45-31. Michigan, who was a top 3 team, I think they were ranked 3rd that year, only 20-10 was that win for Michigan. So they've always been a team that, and like Michigan last year, they always play Michigan tough, it seems. But I mean, they've been a team where it's like, hey, if you're one of those top dogs, don't sleep on them. Don't sleep on this team. And I know what people are going to say, but guys, they got 5 wins last year, 1 more, they're bowl eligible. That is, to me, why I brought up the schedule earlier, because without playing Wisconsin, now it being Minnesota and Iowa, this is a team that might be able to get 2-6 wins on the year.
And Ricky, back to your point of, oh, they've always played Michigan tough. They almost beat they beat Ohio State in 14. They almost upset them in 15. You know what whatever it is, how long? That's the question. But how long are they going to be that team that almost beat the good team?
Mm-hmm.
Indiana, for so long it seems, has been the team that almost beats the good team. But they never become the good team themselves. They've never been able to take the next step. And it really looks like it's been defense. It's been defense that's been keeping them here. But offense is the one that's holding them back because they haven't found consistency there. Which, again, talks to your point of the running game. They need this running game that's going to be anchored by Ellison to really take off, be good, be consistent, and more of those 100-yard games.
Mm-hmm.
They need more of those 100-yard games to ensure that they are staying in these ball games, and eventually it puts them over the top in an overtime, or it puts them over the top in a close game.
Here's what I want to bring up. There's 2 last things I want to bring up. This is one of them. If you look to last year against the big powerhouse teams in the Big 12, or Big 10, they lose 45-17 against Wisconsin. Indiana only runs the ball 21 times. Ellison only had 6 carries in that game, whereas the Badgers had 52 carries. Jonathan Taylor had 29 carries. And I know what you're saying, but Ricky, it was 45-17. It was a blowout, especially in the second half. They ditched the run game. I get that, but also just looking at the fact that Wisconsin had a bell cow. Indiana seemed to not have a bell cow. Then you look at the Purdue game, 31-24 loss, 32 total rushes for the Hoosiers, 13 for Cole Guest, Allison only had 9. You look at the other side, 43 for Purdue. Markell Jones, 31 carries. They had a bell cow in that game. Then you look at Ohio State, a total of 27 carries. This could be another one that people go, Ricky, it was 49-21. Again, ditch the run game because you're getting blown out. 27 total carries for the Hoosiers. 7 was the highest between a couple backs. Ellison was one of them. You look at 51 carries for the Buckeyes. Dobbins had 29 as the main back. JT Barrett also had 13, but he was a dual threat quarterback. But they had a bell cow at the running back position. And then you look at it in Penn State. Indiana loses 45-14. Saquon Barkley, 20 carries in that game. I know McSorley had 16 for the quarterback as well, but he ended with like negative 19 yards with sacks and everything. But then out of 47 runs, Ellison only had 9. So for me, it's like, if he's going to be your main back, give him the rock, man. Because like one of those where you said he was over 100 yards, when they gave him 15, at least 15 carries, he had decent games. That one, he had 25 carries in that game. That's what I want to see from Ellison this year. I can't keep seeing under 10 carries for him if he's going to be your main running back this year.
And neither can Indiana, because they need to be able to take some of the pressure off the quarterback position, especially in a year where you're looking
especially
at a quarterback, okay? Or if it's Ramsey and he's not still 100% with the knee,
yep,
and you need to have a little extra barrier there for him, or a little extra cushion, safety blanket, that needs to be, you know, another help for you as opposed to another receiver, but in addition to.
The last thing I want to bring up is the schedule, because we didn't dive into that as much. As here's my bare bones with the schedule. Indiana should get 3 wins to start. FIU, Virginia, Ball State, win, win, win. My only question is, the 2 games in the Big Ten that I think could be for sure's at Rutgers, at Minnesota, I know they're on the road, those 2 ats put you at 5. If you beat a Maryland this year, who, let's be honest, you could lose that game. If you beat Maryland, that puts you in bowl game. But how many of the other games, Michigan State, Ohio State, Iowa, Penn State, Michigan, and Purdue, are you going to upset one of these teams? In the end, I see this team, a 5-win team, 6-win team at best. If they are a 7-8-win team, they upset one of those top dogs in the Big Ten.
I think that their cap this year is 6. I think their cap this season is 6 wins. Like you said, Ricky, the first 3 games of the season should be victories. I think they get a win on the road at Rutgers. I think they get a win on the road at Minnesota, and I think that they can beat Maryland at home. I just don't see them beating Michigan State. While yes, I've talked that they're close, they've been close, they could be close, I think Michigan State is going to be a good team. I think Ohio State will be a good team. Penn State certainly is going to be good this year in my mind, and Michigan's going to be much improved. It's and everyone who just listened to that said, yeah, those are the top 4 teams on this side. But I think I could see 6 for them. I think I could. Maybe a win over Iowa, which if everything else the way that we've said it, it could be 7, but I think their cap's at 6.
Well, this is where you guys come in. Let us know what you think down below in the comment section. I'll be completely honest, this is another one. I get the Illini last week, why we went longer than usual, because it was very therapeutic for me being an Illini fan. But coming into this podcast, I did not expect to go almost 30 minutes on the Indiana Hoosiers. So this is where you guys come in.
We apologize.
Let us know. Going down in the comment section, let us know what you guys think about this defense, this offense. Who do you going to start at quarterback? Who's going to win the battle? And what do you think about your win total this year in the Big Ten? Let us know what you think down below in that comment section.